How many of us go into panic mode when we're shooting film and then realise that you've set the wrong speed in the camera to the film that you've got and you've overexposed your film? I reckon that's happened to most of us, right?
Are you a big shitbag? Shit.
The common reason is probably not changing your ISO on the camera to match the film inside. So I've loaded some Fomapan 200 inside this camera. And I've got this simple scene here. It's one of my old cameras, a couple of rolls of film and a little letter. The film and the letter came from John Esco, a little gift for me. So thanks, John, if you're seeing this. I'm using your letter for this experiment. So I've got this on a sweeping white background. I've got the two rolls of film there. I've got the camera and I've got John's letter as well, which is a different shade of white to the background. The camera, the bellows here is the darker areas, and obviously we've got highlights going on around the lens and also the background and the papers as well. I've got two lights. I've got this cowboy light which is bouncing off the ceiling and coming back down, and I've also got this little tiny cowboy light here just lighting the shadow areas of my scene. So I'll just do some quick metering on the scene, and it's giving me f5.6 at 1/60th of a second. So I'll take that shot as my metered exposure, and then I'm going to go over one stop, and I'm going to go over two stops, and then over three stops, over four stops, over five and over six stops exposure. So I'm going to be overexposing by six stops. Okay, so now all that's done, all I've got to do is take my shots, overexpose and see what we get. 1/60th, 1/30th, 1/15th, 1/8th, quarter of a second, half a second and 1 second. Proper overexposed. So that's my test shots done. I'm going to go off, cut the film out of this camera, develop it, and in the meantime I'll just talk a little bit about overexposure and development, and then we'll come back and see the results from this film. So unlike digital, most good films have bags of latitude when it comes to overexposure, and we all overexpose from time to time. It's usually because we've metered the scene wrong, used the wrong film, or totally misjudged the Sunny 16 rule, or worse, your lens aperture is stuck wide open. And this digital photograph is doomed. I'm not going to get any detail from this whatsoever, but with film, I possibly can. You can tell instantly if a negative has been overexposed by looking at it on a light box. Let's say you've developed your film properly and your negatives look dense and black like this, the chances are you've overexposed your film. Of course, there is a possibility that you might have overdeveloped the film as well. But if you think you've developed normally and your negatives come out like this, they're overexposed and there's something wrong with your metering or your camera. The guy that inspired me to shoot film, and the reason this channel is called Shoot Film Like a Boss, was good old Stan, the boss. God rest his soul. Once he told me a good test was to place a newspaper under the negative and you should be able to see the words right through most of it. Proper old school stuff. And I found that to be a good guide. And as you can see, this overexposed negative, I can't see nothing through. Let's have a look at a good negative. And as you can see, I can see most of the words, even in the dense parts. A good example of overexposure on your film is your film leader. That was the first thing that got exposed to light when you put it into your camera. So after development, in theory, that should be pretty much jet black. When I develop and test my films, I always like my leader to be a little tiny bit see-through so that I know my photographs on the negatives aren't going to be overexposed, that I can't print any of them. That comes down to the development and testing films and development times. And you can try that yourselves with your own 35mm negs. Pull them out of the sleeves, have a little look at the leader and inspect them. See if any of them are very faint, see if them are very heavy. It'll tell you a lot about the development that you did at the time on that film. And film exposure and development go hand in hand. So I'm going to quickly run through what goes on with the film when you develop it through the chemicals. As best as I know, this is the way that it gets in my head when I'm trying to understand exposure. Hopefully it might help. If not, you can just jump straight to the next part to see the results from the tests that we was doing on the overexposed shoot. So the black and white film in your camera is packed with microscopic light sensitive silver particles called silver halides, and there's billions of them that all react according to the intensity of the light in your scene when you take a photograph. But the magic starts when you put the film into the developer. Those microscopic silver halides that were exposed to light in the camera start to turn into a metallic silver. The longer you develop, the more solid they become. When you pour the developer away after your development time, you then add stop bath chemical. Even though you've poured the developer away, there's still some developer left on the film. So the stop bath washes away the developer left on the film and prevents the exposed silver halides from developing any further. When we put the film in the fixer, it gets to work and washes away all of the silver halides that weren't exposed to light, leaving those shadow and dark areas on the film almost transparent and clear. If we take a film out of the tank straight after the development and the stop, we notice the negative looks strange. Now, I don't recommend doing this unless you're experimenting like I am. Notice that the negative is hardly transparent. You see those milky, foggy areas? These are the areas where the silver halides were less exposed during the photo being taken, such as the bellows, and the developer hasn't turned them into a metallic silver as much as the brighter areas in the scene. If I tried to print this negative now, it would print very flat and have little or no contrast, so we need to clear all those milky, foggy parts on the negative away using the fixer. The fixer will wash away all the milky foggy parts or the unexposed halides on the film and turn them almost transparent, leaving the brighter areas more solid and leaving us with a permanent image on the film that we recognise as a negative. And all this makes sense when we go to make a print. And I'm not teaching you guys how to suck eggs. I know most of you know how all that works. I put that out there for anyone that wasn't sure, maybe to give them a little bit of a heads up. Maybe beginners out there that are watching the channel. And that's my interpretation of how film and exposure and the chemicals work. Some people's interpretations may differ, but that's how it's embedded in my mind, which makes it easier for me to understand it all when I go to shoot, when I go to expose, and when I go to develop my own films. So let's crack on. I'll show you the negatives that I took, and here they are on the light box. And you can see all the different steps of exposure that I took. And if I now put it under the paper, we can see how dense the negative ended up after it overexposing six stops. And by the way, I was using Rodinal developer at 1:50. Other developers would have handled it better, but why make things easy? Rodinal tells the truth. So this film was normally developed, and this negative I shot identical, but I knocked 2 minutes from the development time. And there's not a massive difference, but if we look at these slides, we can see it a little bit better. The top images are from the normal development and the bottom images are from the underdevelopment. Now remember earlier on when I said that negatives can look dense if you overdevelop, and if you don't develop long enough, they can look the opposite, a little bit flatter than usual. And that's what we can see here on the correct exposure. We can see that the underdeveloped neg is a little bit flatter. But check this out, look at the letter on the one stop overexposed underdeveloped negative. The letter has more detail. That's because the underdevelopment has tamed the highlights better. We can see that more so on two stops overexposure. I seem to have the same shadow detail, but again the highlights look far better. And again at three stops overexposure, the underdevelopment has kept more detail in the film packaging. Interesting. And I was using Fomapan 200. Could you imagine if I was using a film like Ilford Delta or maybe Kodak T-Max, which we know contains more silver? Obviously, they're more expensive. The results would have been even better. But the reason for making this video is my mate Ian reached out to me and he said, Roger, he said, I've put a roll of a Fomapan 400 in my camera. He went, I've accidentally shot it at 100. What do I do? And the first thing I said to him was, well, you've only overexposed by two stops. It ain't going to make much of a difference. You'll still get, you know, nice prints from it. But I said, if anything, try and underdevelop the film by 20%. I could have told him to go and stand develop the film because I know he's using Rodinal. But, you know, with stand development, you're not controlling much yourself. The stand development's doing it all for you. I like to think I'm in control of the development and also for the experience as well. So I said to Ian, just knock 20% off the development time and see what happens. He hasn't come back to me yet, so thumbs up, Ian. If they come out all right, let me know in the comments because I know you watch the videos. So I've got the negative now shining on the baseboard. The negative's under the enlarger, light shining through it, and it's coming down onto the baseboard. And if I went to print this, you could see these dark areas here are quite thin on the negative. So the light's going to go straight through these areas here and burn straight into the paper. But you can see my highlight areas are quite dense, where the scene was quite contrasty. I suppose the stops between the highlights and the shadow areas was probably about 6 or 7 stops. My paper can only handle about 5 stops of dynamic range. So I need to allow more time on the enlarger to enable these highlight areas to burn into the paper. Meanwhile, this has already gone jet black. So I need to do a little bit of jiggery pokery with some contrast filters to try and make these highlights work. And you'll see what I mean by that. If we put a piece of paper under there now, and I've opened my aperture to its widest, so it's nice and bright, and we'll just give it a couple of seconds. And I'll put this in the developer. You'll see how dark that 2 seconds gave it. The light went straight through the bellows and attacked the paper instantly. You'll see it coming through. There we go. And you can see this part of the negative, how thin it was. The light has gone straight through and attacked the paper straight away. And now let's have a look at one of the overexposed negatives. We'll go to the one that's five stops overexposed. And we'll put that on the enlarger. And straight away, a massive difference. You can see how dense that is. And you can see how much longer the light needs to pass through this negative in order to expose the paper. But even though this is five stops overexposed, I've still got bags of information here to make a print. So this is the normal print I would have made from the correctly exposed negative. Remember, that background wasn't pure white, it was off-white. So that's the correctly exposed negative that I printed there. Let's have a look at the overexposed neg and see if I could get information out of that one. And this is the overexposed negative by five stops, normal development. And I had to use some contrast filters to be able to make this one work, mainly the contrast zero, which is a low contrast filter to try and build up those whites and slowly get those blacks working. But I managed to get there in the end, and that was five stops overexposed. So it just goes to say that if you do overexpose your film, you can still get information back in a darkroom or even in Photoshop as well. And these little marks here, this is where I haven't fixed it properly. They're only test prints. So the idea of this video is to show you guys that didn't know about overexposure and film that even if you do accidentally overexpose your film 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 stops, you can still generally get some information out of it. And some of the better films such as Deltas and the T-Maxes, they got a much better latitude and more silver content, like I said. So you'll probably be able to get better detail out of those exposed films than the ones I was using. And as for my tests, some people rate Foma 200 at 100 or 80 or whatever. It all depends on how you develop the film. So if you want to start playing around with rating your film with your developer, you're going to have to do some tests and see what comes out best for you. What I do in my development may be completely different what you do in your development. So it's all trying to find your sweet spot and comfort zone with your film and your developer. So anyway, guys, I hope that's helped anyone out there that accidentally exposes their film or gives them some indication what happens when you expose film. These are only my thoughts, and this is what helps me understand light and exposure on film when I'm developing and making prints in the darkroom, and it does help me. Let us know in the comments if any of you guys can add to this for me and others to read. It's always interesting. Thanks a lot. Hope you enjoyed the video, and I'll catch you next time.